Yeah? This is English? Again? Yeah? No, this is Chinese.
Martin from Hong Kong Center, should we avoid genetically manipulated food and vegetable? Because this may be an unplanned human interference in God's plans.
What did they do?
Well, I'm not a gene scientist, so in detail I don't know, but the principle is that you change the genetic code in order to make vegetable more resistant against
insects,
for example. That's one example. Or to be a more fruit, like rice, for example.
Mm-hmm. A lot of people are against it.
Yes.
Do you know the reason why? A lot of people protest, you know, even Prince Charles and many people are against that. Does anybody know why? So that everyone can understand why.
I think the reason is that many believe that it interferes with God's plans and nature.
Mm-hmm. That's it?
And it poses some risk, some health risk, which we don't know at the moment.
Like what?
Like that when we eat this, then our own genetic code may be
altered.
Altered or get some influence from that.
Uh-huh. What did they do to alter the coat of the vegetable? Do you know, by the way? Anybody know? Yeah, come here, come here. If you know, come up here. Come here and we have a nice discussion for a change. Yeah, now you answer. I pose question. Come up here, two of you. There were two persons who wanted to talk about this. Anyone else? Anyone else you know who knows about this? Come up here and give the public some knowledge about this much discussed and less understood subject. Come up here, honey. Come up here. You could have brought your own cushion to be comfortable as well if you want to. It might be very cold there. Is it cold?
No.
No, fine. Just sit there, yeah. Anyone help bring the cushion, please? Okay. You want to answer this?
No, I wait for the sister.
Yeah.
What I know about genetically modified food is that they're actually splicing DNA cells, and they can actually now splice animal DNA cells into
the food. That's what
so
people
that's
don't like.
So that's part of the problem.
Yeah.
Is that vegetarians won't even know if they're eating something that has animal
products in it. Yes. Yes. That's what people protested. Yes.
And the other thing is that they haven't done enough testing, and that they're finding some of the things that they've put into, say, corn, for instance, to protect it from corn bolls, I think they are those, an insect that attacks corn. Well, what's happening now is that when the corn pollinates, the monarch butterflies, which are maybe miles away, but the pollination from the corn plants with this insect poison in it are eating other plants that have, they're collecting the pollen off of other types of plants that have corn pollen on it, and they're dying by the thousands.
Yes, yes.
So it hasn't been tested enough, and there's too many repercussions.
Mm-hmm. That's what I thought. Anything else, honey?
I think she said it all.
Uh-huh. Anything else? Anything else you need to let us know?
Sometimes the modified plants, they also mix with the normal plants, and then the whole crop changes, and maybe there will be no more normal plants of this kind. If the modified plants mix the pollen,
then no more normal plants as well. Yes.
And one time I heard that they tried it with some modified, I think, soya beans or something, and actually the crop they got was less than ordinary, and many plants died, and it even kind of poisoned the soil.
Yes. And they infest the neighboring miles away farm. Yeah.
And they're breeding the seeds so that the seeds will not reproduce. So that every year you can't go out and take the seeds from your crop and replant them. The seeds terminate after 1 year, so that they're only good for 1 year, and they're patenting the seeds so that the seeds are no longer owned by you. They're owned by the corporations that have the patents on the genetically modified food.
My goodness. Yes, you want to say something more.
And I also heard that they kill the insects, that, like the ones that are damaging. But sometimes they kill all kinds of good insects too, or even birds.
Yes.
And it's not controllable.
What do you think is the damage caused by the genetic modified vegetable? So from what we have heard now, you think why people protest?
Well, from the vegetarian point of view, it's mainly these animal cells which get into the plants.
Yeah. I have a question for the sister.
Yeah.
Now, if the corn were genetically identical, wouldn't that be more prone to diseases if they were grown in masses? Wouldn't they be more prone to diseases?
If I missed the first part.
If every crop were to be identical, wouldn't each crop be more prone to a disease?
Actually, they've done some research on that many years ago, back in the 40s, when they were first starting to do like pesticides and herbicides. They had one field that they'd been growing pesticide-induced crops, and one field that was pure organic. And they tested seeds that were organic seeds and then inorganic seeds. And the seeds planted in organic soil did much, much better than any of the others. And right after that, they had like a huge swarm of something like locusts or something like that. And the organic seeds and the organic soil had a much higher survival rate than any of the other, ones with pesticides or herbicides or any sorts of additives. And so the strongest, healthiest plant is the one that's grown from an organic seed in organic soil.
I mean, naturally grown. Yeah, that's for the test. Actually, I have grown some organic in Mali, and it's eaten all by the worms. we don't spray anything. Yeah, we eat with them too, whatever left over, but not much. Actually, we survive up to now without any genetic food, so I don't know why. But you see, because most people out there, they are not vegetarian also, you see? So they see in the point of profit, yes. And they also argue that if they grow genetically modified food, they will have a lot more food and the hungry people will be fed. Theoretically speaking, maybe it sounds good. But we have not tested far enough to know how beneficial or how damaging can that be. But the point is, if they ingest them with animal DNA, then we should not eat them. Yeah? We should not eat them to begin with. Yeah. We just find those normal food to eat. Yeah, but luckily, a lot of farmers and government representatives, they're against it.
I think that I read an article where the governments are very afraid of world hunger. And right now, if you project out, the birth rate and the available soil and all that, it looks like there's going to be world hunger in a number of years. But the article noted that, again, the same arguments that, it takes like between 9 and 30 pounds of grain to make 1 pound of beef. And so if we switch to a vegetarian diet, then those arguments go away.
That's the best. That's the best. Everybody knows that. I mean, a lot of people know that. Not everybody knows that. Some people ignore it. But that's the fact, that we waste so much food and grain and water and medicine and time and energy and manpower just to cultivate animal meat. Whereas if we just eat whatever that there already without having to use that to feed the animals, then we have enough to feed everybody. We should never have any hunger in this planet. We have more than enough. Before we even discuss genetic food, we are already fully fed. If we really are cooperating and more selfless, just like beings in many other planets. Other planets, they don't have hunger because they share. They never think anything that truly belongs to them. Yeah, they just take care of it. Yeah. before we used to look for vegetarian diet, there's no egg and all that, and still sometimes we're still in danger. Because they mix things in everything. Even bread, sometimes they put egg in it. It's just a simple ice cream. Every kid's favorite, they put egg in it. And you never know which one don't have sometimes. It's like just very, for example, you know, very simple thing, basic thing. And sometimes normal thing, a marshmallow, just very simple kid stuff, yeah? Or even apple pie or any pie, they put egg in it. Even bread, just a basic thing. So sometimes I already thought we just have to bake our own food and, you know, and now we probably look like we have to grow our own vegetable. Oh my God. Look like we have to buy an island somewhere and go there and hide together and yeah, yeah. And grow our own food. But that's what people do in the old time. That's how different nations have been born. You see what I mean? For example, Japan, they speak different, but when they're writing, 80% of the Chinese understand them. And when the Chinese write 80%, you know, they understand, the Japanese understand 80%. See what I mean? Yeah. It wasn't Japan. It was probably just an island, and then some Chinese people go there, and they make their symbol of the nation is the sun, you know? Maybe some practitioner went there before, yeah? Symbol of the light. And then beginning later, we lost the tradition, for example, like that.
In Austria, they have part of the produce organic, and they even have it in the supermarket, and it's very popular. They cannot meet the demand.
Okay.
So more people are doing it.
Oh, good. Then
accept it.
I know what to do now. We switch into planting organic food and earn money. Yeah. Mm. Okay, that's good.
1% of the world's produce is organic, and 99% of it comes from the United States right now.
Well, I see organic food also in different supermarkets. It's just a small section. They write organic. And there is a group, they also grow their own food, make everything, remember? What's the name? The what? The Amish. Oh, yes, yes. Yeah. But you have to really be very devoted, yeah, and forsake many of the fun of the city life. Because most of farming cannot be done near the city, yeah? If you don't want to do farming, you have to buy land in far away, it's cheaper.
There's something called the fishy strawberry or the strawberry fish, where they've crossbred a fish with a strawberry in order to make the strawberry impervious to cold.
Well, but master, I think like 95 or even 98% we eat today.
Genetically modified.
And I think the government, they have a regulation that you cannot just like modify any tree and go, you know, sell to the public. Mm. So I think, you know, look at the brighter side, that the government control these regulations because the work hunger. If we can make a genetic code that, you know, not combat all
produce
the insects.
Produce more and more.
Helps all the hungry people in the third world country. I think, look, that's a better side.
Fine, but so, do they stop the hunger right now since the genetic modified food? No. But this is a good positive side. Go on eating your apple and it's no problem, and she's going to organic, you know, each have their own right. Yes, ma'am.
Right now, I think the FDA is the one that people have been trying to get to label this, and if they do ever label it, it'll come to an end fast, I'm sure. It's been a couple of years people have been trying to get them to label it.
Yes, but they right should.
Now, yeah, right now on the internet even, they have their own web page and they're welcoming comments. Mm-hmm. And what everyone really should do is write. If they had like millions of people writing or thousands, hundreds of thousands, it would get, as long as we get it labeled, then it will take care of itself.
Yes, yes. So at least we know which one is what. Yeah, they should be honest, you know, because I know people, a lot of people don't know which one is organic, which one is not. Because not all of them are, not all of them which is not written organic are all modified food, you see? And a lot of people cannot afford the organic price sometimes, so they should label them. That's true.
And they're also rewriting the organic qualifications or whatever, and that's all on the website. That's what they're asking for comments on, too. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure if they're rewriting it to be better or worse.
Mm.
I didn't really read it that much, but if anyone can tune into
it. Okay, you tune into it and you write your opinion. All right? Tell them to label all the organic and all the, at least the modified food, so we know which one is what, with animal or not animal. you know, now we'll be extremely busy. Oh my God, before we go to the food store, we have to read which one have what animal and egg, and now we have to go to the fruit store and read the apple, what kind of DNA is in there. We'll be very busy. You have no more time to worry and to, you know, flare your temper, nothing anymore. That's good, the world will be peaceful. Anything else? So now you know why. Now you make your own choice. Yeah? You know all the reason, and you know all the, you know, the content of the different food. You know what to do. Yeah.
In Europe, many people protested, and then actually they do label it in some supermarkets, in some big companies like food chains.
I know. There are many big companies, they don't sell certain, they don't buy certain food from modified food. Yeah, a lot of protests, and then a lot of them stop, actually. Mm. A lot of experiments for genetic modified food has stopped because people voice their opinion. You make your choice, okay? but the genetically modified food, has it has any bad effects so far? Bad effect, side effect.
I haven't read. There are several books out now. I haven't had a chance to read them.
Uh-huh. Anybody knows?
I've read that sometimes they fear that people can have more allergies.
Allergies. Yes. Because it's so mixed up and the body don't know how to digest. Yeah.
No, I don't know what the side effects are, but supposedly 68%, I think, is the thing. 68% of our food has been grown this way for at least 2 years.
Only 2 years, sometimes it doesn't show yet. Things sometimes take longer time to show the effect, right? Well, let's just hope that whatever it is, since it's already done, let's hope that the people won't have any bad effect. At least if it doesn't help, yeah, it doesn't harm. Since recently we have started the vegetarian fashion, huh? Way of life, and a lot of people has been switched to vegetarian. And then the Maya has to invent whatever, modified animal DNA food. We were just happy that a lot of people turn into vegetarian, even in America, 20% more every year, that's what I heard. And then I was so happy, yeah? And a lot of animal farm has turned into different farm, yeah.
In Austria, we have one initiate who is a farmer for organic vegetables.
Yeah.
And he has a little farm, and it's just about enough for, I think, maybe 20 families or something.
Oh, that's cool.
And it's nice because in summer we can have almost everything from him. And
oh, that's good.
It tastes even much better.
Oh, that's wonderful. Yeah. That's wonderful. Yeah. If you don't have anything else to do, buy a little land somewhere and grow vegetable for us. You see, in Austria, that's what she was talking about. It's in her country, Austria. Austria, it snow and it's cold like half a year. So you can only grow things in summer, in spring and then in summer. So like 6 months you can grow things, right? And other things can grow a little bit, but differently, yeah. In summer you have the most vegetable. And that's a very cold country, you know. It snows sometimes, and sometimes it's very cold, like 10 degrees even. Below zero, it could be. They still can grow vegetable, and just one person enough to feed 20 families. Farming is not an easy job, but it's very rewarding. You know, I heard that the statistic, yeah, research has come to a conclusion that the best happily marriage is a farmer's. Yeah, and then the next are doctors, a third a teacher. So maybe if your marriage is on a rock, you go and dig the rock and and make it into a fertile land and grow vegetable. Maybe that's the best job for everyone, I don't know. Otherwise, how come all the farmers have happy marriage? Must be because the product they make and the sun and the fresh air and they work together and watching things grow and feeling satisfied and happy. And all the people who eat their food feel happy and good, so they partake the happiness of everyone when they eat the food. Maybe. Yeah. Yes?
Most people can always find, like, farmers markets wherever they live, like maybe twice a week.
Find what, honey?
Farmers markets.
A farmer's market. Oh, they sell in the free market. Yes,
they'll come in, you know, for 4 hours a day, maybe a couple days a week.
Yeah, yeah, like weekend or something like that.
And you can usually find an organic farmer there and just try to get most of your food from them.
Oh, okay.
Besides writing to get it labeled.
But since the modified food, do you think the world have become less hungry or not?
Let's say if you grow in apples, you could probably get an organic, you probably get 100 apples a day. Mm. If you do using a modified apple,
1,000, yeah.
You get probably 1,000. So that's the price a lot cheaper and a lot more produced.
Are you sure? Has it been cheaper anywhere?
Well, actually, the productivity per land has been increasing ever since they started doing things like pesticides and everything like that. And the productivity per land kept going up. But now we're reaching the point of diminishing returns, where the productivity is starting to go down, and that's where they're starting to bring in the genetically modified food. However, some research from Rutgers University shows that they went to a supermarket and they bought a whole bunch of vegetables, and then they went to an organic supermarket and bought them, and the organic food had between 50 and 80% more nutrients. And so you may be getting more apples, but the value... the minerals and the vitamins that you get in an organic apple more than outweighs the cost.
Ah, pro and con.
Exactly.
Okay, so, Simin, even if you can buy it cheaper, you pay for less, you know, more empty apple. Yeah, you pay less, but you get less anyway. Or maybe even less than the value that you pay for. All right, so at the end we lose. We lose out to nature. Ah, bravo, God. You are the best. You do everything correctly. Whatever we try to outdo you is not too good. So you mean all this DNA food is no good anyway? Empty. Yeah, just have a bigger container, but nothing inside.
Yeah, like tomatoes have been bred to be uniform size, color, and long shelf life.
How boring.
But not to have nutrient value.
Oh, they have research and there's no nutrient value.
Well, they've bred them, maximized them so that they'll have long shelf life, and it's taken a sacrifice in the nutrient value.
Yeah.
And carrots are modified so that they won't poke through the bag, so that they'll have stubby ends.
I've read a book about people who has grown vegetables very good, very big, only on making shapes with a stone around them. It's called in French like this.
What is it?
Shaping.
Oh, shaping them as big as the
Yes, they tried different forms, uh-huh. And when the insect does not go to the plant, they have found the good form. And then the vegetables grow very, very big, and they are very good, very healthy.
Uh-huh. How do they do
that?
They shape the stone around the plant?
Yes. One woman had the inspiration.
Yeah.
At the end, when they had been very good in that, they wanted to give the good news to everybody.
Yes, okay. See? Good news. If you love your vegetable, they grow.
Yes, and we can
if you really, you must love your job. Yes, it's good. We can try that. Put all the stones around your cabbage and make them grow that big. Yeah, there was some true story.
And in Scotland, they are doing this now. I can have more information
Oh, please, please do. Okay. You can print your magazine, and if any farmer-to-be want to do something for the world, we do that. You see, when we grow with love, in Scotland, you all know this, there were a farmer who loves his potatoes so much, that his potato grows so big, It was a newspaper. What happened to that farmer? He still continue?
Findhorn, it still exists, and they are now trying to use the thing I have spoken, the waves with stones. Oh. They are going to do it.
Oh, yeah. Get more information for us. That's exciting. Okay.
You can also find out which kind of plants like to grow together, because sometimes some kinds, they love to be neighbors.
Against each other, yeah. And sometimes they love to be neighbor and they support each other. Yeah. That's very good. Yeah, if you really put your heart into doing it, and if you really love it, your plant will grow very big, very big. There was some... In Maori, we used to grow each... I give each one a piece of land to grow different things. The one who loves the vegetable and plant, everything grows so nice. People who grow with love, you know, I see their plant go so fast and so much food. Yeah, that's true too. I tell you my experience when I was in America. I didn't have money. Yeah, I live in a temple. And when I first came there, there was a little plant like this, about that big. And they told me it has been there for 5 years. I can't believe it. 5 years, it's that big. And yellow here and brown there and so small, stem very small like this, stem of the flower. And then I just said, 5 years, must be a very funny plant. They don't grow. Mm. So I just water it, you know, and sometimes whatever leftover tea and all that, I give him to drink. Yeah, sometimes I drink tea and I give half to him, yeah, what a leftover. And he grow and grow and grow, my God. And he becomes so big, and you know, the stem was so big like that, and it grows so big. And it was about that, like that, in a small pot like that, and yellow, half brown. And he grows so much, and then I have to cut some of them and put in another pot where I found outside, or any plastic cup or whatever, plastic bottle, you know, and I cut it out, and then another one grow again. And then later I had to cut it more, and then I don't have no more pot and plant, so I moved these already grow outside, put it in front of the temple. Everybody passed by, they just take it home. I have no more room for it. He grows, and you know, I just from tea and water, and that's it. And the abbot of the temple asked me, "What kind of fertilizer did you buy?" I said, "What do you mean, what kind of fertilizer? I don't even have money. I don't have any pocket money at that time. I just work for free." So he knew. And even later, when he talked about it, he talked to his disciples, and his disciples come tell me about it. Otherwise, how do they know? They were not in New York, you know. And they say, when the master talk about you, he say, "You are too much love, and all the plant grows so fat, so big." Yeah, when you have love, things grow too. Yeah, so maybe that is a better alternative than the genetically modified method, huh? Nevertheless, we don't mean to criticize. They have tried, yeah? And they have been excited over some possibility of a world hunger ending, or, you know, more profit even. Maybe in the beginning it was Manuel, and later on the business people manipulate it and monopolize it and make it become something else. From there, they step further and inject animal stuff in there just to experiment, to make more profit and things like that. So it ends up that the process has been devoid of love. And that's why people protest them, because when they eat them, they don't feel good. They don't feel love. They don't feel contented.
I know somebody who works in a restaurant, and they commented recently that they don't know why, but the last year or so, everyone's been asking for aspirins. Yeah. Everyone's been having headaches all the time, people she works with and everything.
Because sometimes the effect of love devoid in food is not so physically, and it's not so obvious. You would think, you have a headache, or you think you have a dizziness, or you feel vomiting. But it might be somewhere. Yeah, they might think, okay, it's pollution, I overwork, I don't sleep, or anything we do. Because headache people often have, they don't think about it.
But some of our brothers and sisters, we switched to organic and we feel a lot better since cool. we did
yeah,
it.
Yeah, I believe you.
And we even meditate better. I yes. can feel the difference if I eat really very pure food. I can sit more still. Sometimes yes. I get agitated when I eat food that's not very good for me.
Right, right. It's true. Confirm with you. Yes. A lot of time when I go on the airplane, I just cannot eat anything. If some people in the kitchen, if they love their job, they do it devotedly and with love to offer things to people, the food tastes better. Yeah. So sometimes the same person cook but in a different mood, I also feel different. Yeah.
I think it's also important to have things that are really fresh. Because I learned that if, for example, flour, if it's very fresh, just ground, it's much more nutritious, even if you just keep it for a few hours.
Yeah, yeah, it's true. It's true. Yeah. Yeah, in India, for example, when I taste the chapati there, it tastes better than here because they ground it with the stone kind of grinder. Huh? What is it?
Mortar.
And they do it every day or maybe just for every couple of days. They don't do it a lot. They do it at home, you know, and just a little quantity, enough for 1 or 2 days or 1 or 2 meals. Yeah, and it tastes like heaven. Also in Italy, for example, I eat spaghetti there. It tastes different than I eat here in any hood at all, in any pizza restaurant. Tastes different. Rarely you can find some good one. In Singapore, that is a different, yeah. In Singapore, I had one favorite restaurant. Sometimes I went there to eat pizza. Sometimes I could eat 1, 2, or 3 pizza. No, the thin one. They call margherita, very thin and small. But it's so nice, and I don't know why it's the same looking like in other restaurants, don't taste so good anymore, don't taste so good. So I asked them, what do you do with the pizza, how did you do it? He said, oh, we don't have this pizza today. I said, why is that? He said, because the flour didn't come yet. They imported the flour from Italy, the one that is good, that place is good. That's why the quality always the same. It's not just like anything. Maybe in that reason they grow organic flour or it's especially good in that region. So they keep shipping it in. And if they don't have flour, they don't make margherita pizza. Yeah, that's how I find out. Oh, it has to be different. It has a little different. When I was in Germany, I was married, yeah. My ex-husband and I, we grow tomatoes, and the tomato just crawling on the ground because there's so many, many fruit, so much he crawl on the ground. He cannot stand no more. We give him a lot of legs, but he's still crawling there. So much food, and it tastes so good. And when I was younger, as a kid, I grow also vegetable for fun. You know, I grow tomato and all that, and it tastes also so good. I hardly can find such a tasty tomato anymore. Even though now they grow bigger than my tomato, but don't taste so good. There's no fragrance. I don't know. There's something in a tomato that makes you like it so much. And some old tomato, it tastes just like water. Mm. So it could be the organic and the love they put into it, yeah? So you be careful what you eat, guys. It affects your meditation also, according to experience. Oh, that's enough with food right now, okay. Anything else better than food? Yeah, but it's important to know. Sit there, brother. Sister, don't worry, just go over here, don't worry. Anybody else who want to discuss about food, just come over here. Or if you would like to move here and sit, it's fine. Yeah, it's fine. Okay, what else?
My question is that before I got initiated, I had already heard a sound. And after I got initiated, this sound is more clear and beautiful.
Mm. That's right.
And when I do daily job, driving a car or washing a dishes,
you can also hear the sound.
Yeah,
yeah. That's good.
Is this okay or
it's okay. It's okay. It's very good. It should be that way.
Thank you.
Yes, yes. You're welcome.
This is a little ridiculous question. Don't laugh at me.
Too bad. We can't keep the promise. Never mind. Oh, we just laugh with you.
Okay. Before question, I'd like to say to you, I like your new hair, Carol.
Yeah, I like it too. Yeah.
And my question is, you have a nice fragrance, and what's it come from, and what is it?
Where?
You.
Right now?
I don't know.
Now? I'm sorry, I don't put any fragrance today.
Not now, because anyway, now it's many flowers around here, so maybe...
The flowers. Flowers. Mm.
But when...
Can you come near and smell if it's still there? Then I can tell you, because I don't have any. No, go ahead.
I don't know now, today, but usually. When... Nice when you were in Tokyo, in lecture, we could smell.
Mm-hmm. Mm, sometime I put something on, I don't remember. Maybe perfume. Today, no. Today, nothing. Nada. Yeah, sometimes people give me some perfume. I buy them duty-free at the airport. But I don't think... I don't often put on. Sometimes I don't put anything. People still say it smell. Sometimes I put a lot, people don't say anything. So I'm not sure if I put anything in Tokyo or not. Is that what it is?
That's all.
What does it smell like? A rose or...
Really? I don't know how to say.
Like this? I don't think.
Today it's the same smell.
Same smell all the time?
No, I don't know, because when I feel it, you were in Tokyo.
Oh, yeah.
And this time, the same smell, maybe flowers
here.
Smell.
Oh, must be flower, then they put a lot of flower around my stage. Yeah? Oh, when I walk around you? Mm. Oh, then I can't be guaranteed. I don't know. I couldn't put so many perfume on in one time. No idea. Okay, no idea.
Thank you.
Well, at least it don't smell bad, and that's fine. Good news. Yeah. Thank you. That's your question? It's very cute. Now you talk about it, I'm afraid everybody's run around me and just try to smell. Anybody else smell something?
Yes.
Yeah? What kind? Sandalwood. Flowers. Oh, sandalwood. I don't have it right now. Any of them. Yes?
Sometimes I went to Austin Center to work. Mm-hmm. In the house, you been there before? That's after 3 months. 3 years
old,
and 4 years after that, it still smells good. Yeah. Every time I went in, it smells so good.
Yeah.
Yeah. Kind of like a sandalwood.
Yeah.
Yeah. Much more than perfume.
I don't know. Yeah. I don't use sandalwood perfume anyway. Yeah, oh, that's
it's
good.
Natural. Yeah, I love it. And even I cover something, I still hear it.
Do you smell it?
Yeah, I
you
still
hear the smell.
Yeah.
This is Vietnamese translated into English. In Vietnamese, we say we hear the smell. Nghe mùi, yeah? Are you Vietnamese by chance? I'm sure. Are you? Oh, yeah, yeah, I know. This is a Vietnamese translation into English. And hear the smell, yeah. Hear the fragrance. You're welcome. Yeah. In Vietnamese, we say, in Vietnam, you know, the country, the word for country is nước, it also means water. So all the Vietnamese say, I came from water, Vietnam. When they first came. It's very cute. Actually, the way the Vietnamese people use it is also correct, because we don't also smell with the nose, you know? We smell with our wisdom inside. We can hear the smell too. Then why not, right? Because we don't hear with the ears anymore, and we don't see with the eyes anymore, and so anything is correct. So the way they use it is probably from the ancient time, when people were still very spiritually conscious. Okay, first we have food, and now we have smell. What next? Everything. All kind of sensational. All right, that's good. There's no question next, huh? That's it? That's the question you all want? And some more? Yeah.
Okay, the question is, I just realized one thing. When every time we live in the world, every minute, but as you said, is a school. So every second or every minute is studying, even your sleep. Is that correct? I ask
the question?
Yeah, I ask the inner master, and the answer is yes.
Yeah, sure. Not really a school. It's just the thing you should know, the thing you should remember. All the things you think you learn is all the thing you already knew. Just now you begin to remember. And every minute, every second, you remember more about yourself or anything that's useful or not useful from your past inner wisdom. Yeah? Then, of course, you can say that's cool, but actually you know everything already. Right. Everything I said to you, everything you asked me, everything I answered, you already knew. Just either you wanted to remain ignorant for fun, or you just don't realize that you know. That's why you have to dig inside your wisdom and understand it. Yeah? I don't really need to say anything to you. By meditating together alone with me or with fellow initiates and thinking of the Master, you will also know the answer. Just sometimes you are impatient, or sometimes you are too busy outside, yeah? And you get a confused message inside and you don't know whether it's true or not. Yeah. But everything that you ask me, you already knew. Or at least the Master answer you inside right away. If we calm down, we know everything. So you can say it's a school, but we don't have anything else to learn anymore, actually. We already knew everything. We are Buddha. Yeah? We have forgotten. So the moment we get enlightened, we begin to remember. So every second, every time, of course you remember more. That's a kind of school too. Yeah? You know how to react with a certain situation, and you know how to deal with certain problems. These are not because you learn, but because you really remember.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Nobody can teach a Buddha. Can awaken a Buddha, but not to teach a Buddha. Everything you ask me here is just for the brain. Just to amuse yourself and just to clear your brain of some problem. Otherwise, you know everything inside. Everything you need to know, you have. Every talent you need for fun, you have. Yeah, everything you know already. Just to remember. And the Kuan Yin and the Quan Quang, the light and the sound, will help you to remember, because that's your real self. The light and the sound is your real self. The more you remember your real self, the more you know everything that you knew before. See what I mean? So everything you don't know is because of the brain obstructed you. Every wrong information, every wrong reaction you do is because of the brain. It distorted the information from your own wisdom, filter it and make it wrongly, make it less than accurate. Yeah? Okay. Yes, ma'am?
Master, I would like to have a question, please. There are two kinds of Buddha.
poor Buddha and rich Buddha,
two kind of Buddha.
And that means there exist a lot of kind of Buddha, right?
Yeah, yeah. Some and then poor Buddha, some rich Buddha.
And then suffering and happy Buddha, right?
True.
Wow.
Wow. No, the Buddha inside is the same. It's just the outside circumstances. We are born into different situation, and we have different marked destiny and road to go. Yeah.
And we, of course, do not want to be a suffering Buddha.
You don't want to be?
Yes, of course.
It's too late.
Not. I don't think it's.
For example, before you were born, yeah.
Yes.
Before you born into this life, you have chosen a path to go. All right. Suppose you don't like that path now. Of course, you can change.
Okay.
You can change. But I don't walk that path.
And at least we can become rich.
Oh, sure.
Sure. Okay, thank you.
Change. And change your way of thinking. Change your business.
Uh-huh.
Change your way of managing your money. You become rich. You become rich not always by earning more, but by saving more. By managing more of your life. By simplify your life. Buying only what really necessary. And only what really suit your pocket, yeah? Never buy more so that you have to pay mortgage and pay debt and that the interest is very high and you will pay more than you earn, you see? Being rich, not always necessarily that you have millions of dollars, but nevertheless you can also, yeah? The more you save, the more you reach, yeah? Mm-hmm. The richer you become. Most people, they spend a lot even though they earn a lot, so they are poor, yeah?
Yes.
Before, I don't have a lot of money, but I'm always rich because I never had any debt.
So I think that at least we can hope that we can be richer in the future.
Oh, sure,
because
can hope. Hope you can always.
Become Buddha the most difficult we can.
I have already told you how to become rich in the last lecture somewhere. You have to look for that tape, okay?
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. It's very easy to be rich, believe me. Very easy. Just have to know how, where to look for opportunity, yeah? And what to do. Very easy to become rich. Easier than anything else. It's not that difficult to become rich. Just most people don't think they could become rich. And what you think, you become. You are powerful. Set your mind to become rich, then you will be. Okay? The main reason is you want to become Buddha? But the rich Buddha is even better, for sure, I know that. Why not, huh? More fun, huh? Yeah. Yeah, okay. I could also tell you a few tips. Yeah, I have told you some of it, yeah? You can do your own business. But doing your own business is risky, yeah? So you choose to have a peaceful life, you know, 8 to 5 and earn a fixed amount of money every month, or you choose to take a risk to become a businesswoman, make your own business. Before you start to venture into business, you have to look for what kind of business you want to do and whether you are capable in that business or not. Don't do a business just because a neighbor do it, because it looked good and glamorous. Because you have a bigger title. No, no, no. If you want is money, then you have to look for a business, however low or don't have title or don't look glamorous, don't look good, business. You have to look for the business that make money. Understand? So that is the main point. Look for a business that you can do, that you're capable, and not too many competition. And for sure we make money, and not to have too much capital to begin with. And even if you lose a business, you don't lose much. You see what I mean? Because a lot of people, why they lost business? Because they just do what the neighbor do. Oh, they see the neighbor make a lot of aoyai dress and earn a lot of money. Oh, I open a one, even though she didn't know how to. You see what I mean? And they saw people open restaurant and very prosper, a lot of customer come in. I also open a restaurant, even though I have no experience about restaurant. So before you do a business, anybody can do a business and can be successful. If you love your business, and if you are not too aim too high, and not to risk too big a capital, see? You do small business, make less capital, but earn more in later. And even if you lose business, you don't go bankrupt because very less capital. There's so many business that you can earn a lot of money but don't have to put a lot of capital. Yeah? And in the beginning, if you are not sure, you can keep your job and do business on the side, or depends on how much money you have, on how much you want to go into that business. But you must love your job. You must love the business that you do. You must put all your heart into it, and you become rich in no time. But you don't spend everything that you earn. That's the main question. You have to buy anything that is worth every penny you spend. You even have to buy second-hand clothes or anything that you can use but without having to spend the hard-earned money, you see? And the more money you have, the more you can earn, because that's investment in the bank even. In the bank, even you put money in the bank, like deposit, in like you put $10,000 in a very good earning bank. You have to know which one earn good. And you put like investment in, like 20 years later, you have like $100,000. And that you can make another business or earn or invest more in it, you see? And that's how you have money. You don't just spend everything. I have a good car and beautiful clothes. All these are just empty. A lot of people have a big business car and business company and drive very good car, but they have big debt. Yeah, they spend more than they earn. If you look at a person who drive a beautiful car and wear beautiful clothes, you think he's millionaire, you're wrong. Most millionaires don't drive this flashy car and don't wear so big stuff. They just happy because they have money. They don't need to show. Yeah. Sometimes they buy second-hand car because they don't need to pay luxury tax. That saves you $10,000. And it drives the same. A lot of car, they just drive like 200-300 miles and then they're fed up, they sell it. Yeah. And you can buy that kind of car for like half of the money less. You see, or at least one-third less. And you don't pay even luxury tax. And it drives better still, drive good, all the same. For example, and you can buy like clothes that's a reasonable price. You don't have to go to buy designer clothes. You think what I mean? And you look smart, you look good. Because you know how to dress, you don't have to pay a lot of money. Or sometimes you go and buy second-hand clothes in the movie star shop, you know, very expensive clothes, but they sell them very cheap, and you still look smart. For example, like that. You have to know how to manage your money. And you buy food in a wholesale, and then you make marmalade and all that and save it. For example, when it's cheap, that's how people become millionaire. Not just by earning, not just by risking to do business, but by also saving. They really know. They squeeze the last drop out of their toothpaste. They don't throw half away. Yeah? Everything you save, that's what you earn. And it's very easy to be rich, believe me. Before, you know, I didn't have any money. I was a monk. Don't have any money. But I don't want to take money from people either. So I do a lot of things. I grow bean sprout. Yeah, even so many layers. You just put the beans on it and then put another layer of cloth and then I sell a lot. For example, I already can earn money. Later, I have a lot of people following me and stay with me as resident, and I have to feed them also. And we think of the way to make money together. So I went and buy some very cheap material that they on sale from last year, but which never out of fashion, you know, like warm cloth and things like that, will never be out of fashion. And we make a poncho, you know, like warm coat out of it, and we make guanyin cloth and all that. Yeah, we sell it to people. And we bought very cheap, you know, because we bought the wholesale and on sale, and the whole in the wholesale in the company, they want to get rid of them, because they make new one every year, so the old one they sell cheap. And then so we earn money also. Everything you can do, yeah? And there are many things, many, many small way to make business people look down upon because the job is not glamorous. So don't look for glamorous title. Look for where to make money. Because sometimes you open a restaurant. For example, just restaurant business. Most Vietnamese like to open a restaurant. And they like to open a very, very big restaurant with white cover, you know, and white... I say, serviette, yeah, and everything glassy and glossy and very luxury looking. But that earned very little money because you have to pay for laundry and you have to pay for waiter changing up and down, a lot of things, much, much trouble. But some people, they open a restaurant like fast food, like coffee shop. Oh, they earn a lot of money. And even those who sell hot dog outside, they earn a lot more money than some big restaurants in the beginning. Big restaurant, you have to have a lot of money to fall back on. Because in the beginning, not too many customers come and you have to pay for waiters and tax and cleaning napkin and every little thing you have to pay. But like fast food, you don't pay for napkin, for example. You don't pay for tablecloth. You don't need too many waiters. And you do it yourself. Or the people who sell the hot dogs then, you don't look down upon them. They earn a lot of money. They don't have any capital. They don't need any. For example, like that. Yeah? And they pay very less tax because they don't have a restaurant to pay. They don't have personnel to pay. So look for the thing that make money. Yeah? Even you just buy a hot dog stand, you know, vegetarian hot dog. Okay, please. Or tofu stand or whatever, it's just somewhere that where a lot of people go in, come in and go in, yeah? You earn very fast because you sell more. In the restaurant, you sell maybe big, big money for one time, but how many big one time you can earn like that? But for those hot dogs, you sell him, you know, every second, one or two or three, and then you earn because of the big chunk. You earn money very fast. This is just for example. Don't just all go out and sell hot dog, please. I'm just saying the example between the glory and the money. Yeah? If you want is money, look for the money. However humble the job. If you want glory, of course, then you know where to go. Okay? Very easy to be rich, trust me. You already have it here. So many ideas flowing through you every day, just realize it, okay? Choose, pick which one idea is suitable, and then you can make money, okay?
It's again my idea, okay?
Yeah.
It's not rich of me, poor, I don't mean that.
I know that. By the way.
Some of us here are poor, and some of us
are rich.
Then we become rich, Buddha and poor Buddha, is that right?
That's right also, but because they don't want to. Yeah, oh, a lot of kind.
Didn't have a suffering Buddha and happy Buddha. Is that right?
Suffering Buddha, no. We are all Buddha already anyway. So some are suffering, some are happy. You see what I mean? Whether you practice or not, this is the life. Some people are happy, some people are rich, some people are poor. But what I mean is after you enlighten, you can change your destiny also. If you don't harm anybody by being rich, you could change. Yeah? Yeah. And then you make a lot of money, you help people. It's no harm. But if you see any poor Buddha here, because they don't want to be rich, they have the right to not to be rich. Yeah, you can use money in different way. But some people like to remain humble, you know? They don't want to change their life. But if you want to, I tell you, you can. That's all, okay? Being rich and poor is not because you might not be able to earn more, but because you save more and you know how to manage. And that's allowed within the law of the karma. That is allowed. For example, in this life, you're allowed to have only $100. But with $100 you have given to you, you can invest more. That's up to you. You can do it. But only with that $100 capital, for example, like that. You see what I mean? So that's allowed. You can change your life. In some corner, you can like, for example, in a busy traffic, yeah? You can zigzag your way and go faster, yeah? You didn't break any law, yeah? And you didn't go any faster, but you just, you know, zigzag your way if you're busy. Yeah, that's the way. Okay, it's nice to be rich. It's cool. Yeah, actually, nothing changed. After being rich, you will know nothing changed. That's why many people don't care. Yeah, they just remain poor Buddha. They're happy that way. This is also right, yeah. Okay, fine. Anything else? That's a very cute question. You came directly from Hanoi?
Yes.
Just now?
Last Saturday.
But you stay in the United States or are you going back home?
No, I live in Hanoi.
You live in Hanoi still?
Yes, I'm working in Hanoi also.
And you can come here?
Yes.
Like that?
Yes, on business way.
Oh, that's good. Okay, you see, business is good.
Yes.
Huh? You see that? Yeah. When you are a businesswoman, you're more free. So making money is not bad. Continue. Please.
Oh, thank you.
Money helps you.
Thank you.
Yeah. You have the right to travel because you are a business person. That helps also a lot. Yeah. You can come here easier than most of the ordinary Vietnamese people. So you see, I tell you, make money is good. Yeah. Whatever you like is fine. Whatever you like is fine. It's no big deal having money. You also eat one or two meals a day and wear only one clothes at a time. Right? Yeah. And I tell you, all these beautiful clothes sometimes is not comfortable to wear. It's very official. You have to sit this way, and you have to walk that way, and you have to talk that way. Okay, any more questions? Okay, guy, if you don't have any more important questions, we meditate, okay?
Master.
Yeah? What? Who? Where?
This, Master.
Scare me.
I mean, I want to ask you, how do we justify if a dream has a spiritual value or just simply a dream? Or let me say, if a dream is a spiritual experience or not, how do we justify this, Master?
Well, if you wake up and remember everything, and it's very clear to you, then you know. Yeah? Most of a dream is just overflow of the mind's impression, so you will forget it. Yeah? If some dream have deep impression to you, you know it. You have intuition. Okay?
Yes, Master, thank you.
Welcome. Thank you.